In this video, we're going to walk through some prompting techniques and best practices for working with Nano Banana to generate images with AI. In my previous video, we already looked at how to access the Nano Banana API with Python so that we can use it to build our own image generation apps. But the quality of the output can sometimes be hit and miss. So to get the most out of it, we'll have to learn what techniques work best with Nano Banana. Now, all of these things that I'm going to share with you today were taken directly from Google's official image generation guide itself, which I will link in the video description. We're going to go through these techniques and then use it to generate some examples for ourselves so that we can get some real hands-on experience with it and then see the actual results. In this video, we'll be covering effective ways for generating images, editing images, and 6 best practice techniques for working with Nano Banana in general. The code for this project is going to be in Python, and all the code prompts and outputs will be available on GitHub. But having said that, these prompting techniques are useful for anyone using Nano Banana, whether you're doing it through Python or just through the UI on Google AI Studio. All right, let's get started. Generating images with Nano Banana is super easy. Just describe what you want it to generate, and it should just work. However, there's a couple of templates and prompts that will help you generate images of a specific style. Let's take a look. For realistic images, like photos, here's the example prompt template from the guide that works quite well. You can take a moment to read this, but the thing you'll notice here is that you have to be very specific about every visual element. And it's okay if the entire prompt is a paragraph long. Notice how we're controlling the shot type, the lighting, the camera settings, and even the aspect ratio. Although I have to say, in my actual testing, I haven't seen consistent results with Nano Banana actually respecting the aspect ratio. But let me show you what this looks like in practice. For this portrait example, I used a close-up portrait as the shot type and a street musician in their 60s as the subject. And then for the lighting, I specified warm artificial tunnel lighting mixed with cool fluorescent overhead lights. And you can see the results here. I think it looks pretty good, and it followed the instructions quite well. Here's another example. It's a mountain hiker shot in the Scottish Highlands. I specified wide shot to capture the whole landscape and a rugged alpine terrain during golden hour. And then you can also get quite technical with the camera. So here we specified 24mm wide angle lens at f8. And I'm not super into photography either, but if you use the right terms like these ones here, it might help you get the shot that you want. Finally, here's a few other examples using this exact prompt template. They almost have a cinematic quality to them. And it's true, you can still quite easily tell that it's AI generated, but I do think that they still look pretty good. Now, if you wanted to create illustrations or artwork rather than photorealistic images, there's a different template that works really well for that. This template focuses more on artistic elements like the illustration style, color palette, and shading techniques rather than the camera setting. For this Studio Ghibli example, I created a botanist examining a glowing mushroom in Enchanted Forest, and I used the word retro anime style with a muted sage green color palette. And we can also specify soft cell shading with warm ambient lighting for that Ghibli look. And you can see it really captures the atmosphere quite well. Here's another image of an animal in a 3D animation style, again using the same prompt template. And I think it does a pretty good job at nailing the style and the details as well, especially when it comes to adapting things like the hat and the backpack to the character. And here's a couple more examples using the exact same prompt technique for illustration styles. You can see the range of styles is quite wide. So on the left, you could see like a cute cartoon sticker style. In the middle, it's a more realistic hand-painted watercolor. And then on the right is more of a traditional hand-sketched or pen and paper style. I also want to point out that the text in the last example is also really good. And that's interesting to me because text is something that image generation AI typically tends to struggle with. For commercial product shots, here's another template that focuses on the product, professional studio lighting, and composition. And if you look at the prompt, you see key phrases like high resolution, studio lit product photograph, and ultra realistic with sharp focus. Here's an example for a skincare product. I specified a frosted blue glass bottle, and it's set against a background with a white sandy texture. There's also some specific instructions about soft lighting and how the light shines through the bottle. And you can see in the shadow, the light actually has a bit of a blue glow from going through the bottle. So I don't know how Nano Banana was able to figure that out, but I found that that was a really nice realistic touch to the image. And then if you kind of zoom in on the texture of the sand, I also find that it's really sharp and really detailed. And again, you can use this exact prompting technique with a bunch of different products as well. Here's a couple more examples I tried with that, including a watch and a pair of of headphones, and I think they all look pretty good. Now, moving on, one of my absolute favorite features of Nano Banana is that it can also edit existing images, and it's super good at that. Here is an example prompt for editing an existing photo with a text description. So how it works is that you can upload a photo to Nano Banana and then ask it to modify specific parts while keeping everything else the same. This technique is called inpainting. And again, here's the prompt template for that. For this example, I uploaded this living room photo and asked it to change the sofa to a navy blue color. And as you can see, it kept the lighting, the walls, the coffee table, and everything else exactly the same, but it only changed the sofa color. And as I mentioned earlier, this technique is called inpainting or semantic masking, and it's really useful for making targeted edits to an image. Here is another example, except that in this one, we're turning the floor and the TV cabinet into a walnut wood material instead. And if you want to change multiple things, you could try to do that all in one prompt, or it might be more effective to kind of do it in several steps. But that's a technique that we're going to cover later as well. Another thing you could do with Nano Banana is combining elements from multiple images. For example, here's a prompt template for taking an outfit from one photo and a picture of a model from another photo, and then combining them so that the model is wearing that outfit. Also notice in the second sentence of the prompt, we're kind of summarizing again what we want as a final result. So we're kind of re-emphasizing that we want a realistic, full body shot of the model wearing that outfit. And we also want the lighting and the shadows to kind of be blended in naturally with the background elements. Here's an example of running that exact prompt, having the model in this photo wearing this yellow dress. Now, this one is actually quite interesting because if you take a close look at the dress, especially the way it's spread out, it doesn't actually look like it's respecting the laws of physics. It's kind of cut out from that first picture and then pasted on top of the second one. At least that's how it looks to me. So this is probably not the most convincing example. So then I tried it again with another example, and I think that this looks much better. This time, they are wearing a tracksuit outfit. And this one is really impressive because the outfit photo actually has several items: the jacket, the trousers, and the shoes. And you could see as well that in this case, that the shape and the angle of the outfit is actually updated to match the model's pose. So this is a much better output. For me, it's hard to tell that this was even edited. So now that we've gone through a bunch of different ways you can use Nano Banana to generate or edit images, let's take a look at the 6 best practices mentioned in the official guide. The first one is about being hyper-specific with your descriptions. The example provided here is that if you wanted to create an image of fantasy armor, instead of just saying fantasy armor, you could describe it in a lot more detail. For example, you could say something like ornate elven plate armor etched with silver leaf patterns and a high collar and pauldrons shaped like falcon wings. It's quite a long description. But anyway, here's the difference between the generic prompt and the detailed one. Quality-wise, I'd say it's very subjective as to which one is better. I think the generic prompt actually still does a pretty good job. But the point of this example is just to really show you the degree of control you can have over the details. The second technique is to provide context and intent about what the image will be used for. So the example here is that if you had a skincare brand called Aura, instead of just saying create a logo for Aura, you could say create a logo for Aura, a high-end minimalist skincare brand. And you could see how the contextual version understands the brand positioning and creates something much better, more simple and elegant for that specific use case. So even if you don't go into detail about how you want the image to look technically, just kind of providing the context for it will already give you much better results, as you can see. The third technique is about using conversational refinement. So you kind of iterate and refine on your images. You don't have to get the perfect image on the first try. So here you could start with a basic scene, like this picture of this car in the city, and then you can ask for specific changes, like make the car bright yellow, and then update the scene to have cooler, bright daylight, and make the trees more green. Here you could see how each iteration builds on the previous one. First, we get the basic composition, and then we adjust the car color, and then we can fine-tune the lighting and the environment. This will let you kind of dial in exactly on what you want without having to start over from scratch each time. And this is especially useful if you have a complex image or a complex scene that you want to create. And speaking about complex scenes, the fourth technique is about breaking complex scenes down into sequential steps rather than trying to describe everything all at once. And this is a little bit different from the previous technique where we're actually kind of generating a new image at each step. This is still done in one prompt, but we're kind of breaking the prompt up into separate steps. So instead of describing the scene in just one sentence, like the first one up here, you could say, first, create a background of this misty forest, and then in the foreground, add a moss-covered altar, and finally, put a glowing sword stuck in the altar. And the step-by-step approach will give you better control and composition over the final result that you will get. When you try to describe everything at once, sometimes the details can get lost, or maybe they conflict with each other. The fifth technique is called semantic negative prompts. Now, what this simply means is that instead of saying something like no cars, you can describe the scene positively instead. For example, an empty, deserted street with no signs of traffic. Now, I didn't really run any tests or examples for this one, but I think it should be pretty straightforward, especially if you are struggling with removing some elements from your image. The sixth and final technique is about using photographic terminology to control the composition of your scene. You can specify things like wide angle shot for landscape scenes, medium shot with 70mm lens for portraits, or macro lens for detailed shots or close-ups. And here you could see the same subject, a black swan, shot with different camera settings. And as you can see as well, this has a huge effect on what type of image and effect you get at the end. So that pretty much covers the official Google image generation guide. I actually didn't include all of the examples and prompts, just the ones that I thought were the most valuable. But you can check out the actual guide yourself, and the link will be in the description. As always, all of the code for this project and all of the exact prompts used for these images are available on GitHub. The link is in the description as well. I hope this was useful, and I'll see you in the next one.